Ahí, perfecto. Cuando quieras.
Okay, good morning, we will start. Today's seminar will be on Mars ultraviolet air flow and will be presented by Dr. Francisco Galindo. Dr. Galindo was born in Granada, and he made his PhD on 2006 under the direction of Miguel Ángel López Valverde on the development of computational models to calculate atmospheres. Then he moved to Paris to the Meteorologic Dynamic Department on the University of Paris, where he made a postdoc there. And in 2009, he returned to Granada and start to work or continue to work here in the group of atmospheric physics on terrestrial planets. Now he's doing a research on global climate changes, and he, from 2016, he was named by ESA as one of the four scientific who is on the mission of Mars Express. He's co-I in the NOMAD instrument, in the ExoMars mission, and collaborator in the instrument IUVS in the MAVEN mission from NASA. So, it's your talk. Thank you.
Thank you, René. Just before starting, as you sometimes ask for some science news, I have one science news related to Mars, but not related to this seminar. Is that the next rover that will impact Mars, the Martian surface by European Space Agency, the ExoMars 2020 rover, has officially now a name. Has been, I know Pepa is going to like this. It's going to be named Rosalind Franklin, who is the girl who contributed to the study of the DNA molecule, but never received a Nobel for it. So now moving to the seminar, I'm going to talk about airflow on Mars using data from two different space missions and a world model. So this work is the result of a collaboration with many different teams, the teams in the instruments missions, the team building the model, and also the team here in Granada. And part of this work was made within the frame of the Upwards Horizon 2020 project that finished last year and that was led by Miguel here in the East. So this is the outline of the talk. I'm going to start with an introduction. First, I will talk about airflow in general, some basic features of the Martian atmosphere, and I will introduce the motivations for this work and the tools we are using. And then, in the first part, I will just summarize a paper we published last year about the emissions in the dayside of the planet. In the second part, I will present some recent results about the airflow in the night side of the planet, and then I will finish with some summary conclusions. So, starting by the beginning, what's airflow? Broadly, very broadly speaking, airflow is just light emitted by the atmospheric the atoms and the molecules in our atmosphere. So I'm sure that this definition, probably what comes to your mind, is this thing, aurora. And that really fits into the definition. That's light emitted by the atmosphere. But that's not all the light that is emitted by an atmosphere. You can see that in this nice picture taken by the International Space Station, where you can see the aurora, these green and red stripes here, but you can also see some other light emitted by the atmosphere. It's much more widespread, that this does not show as much structure at the aurora. And this is airflow, or this is part of the airflow, the visible part of the airflow. We can distinguish between airflow and aurora, but this is not fully, there is not full consensus on this, by saying that aurora are initiated by the interaction with the atmosphere of energetic extraplanetary energetic particles, atoms, ions, and molecules. For example, in the case of the Earth, the particles could be the particles of the solar wind that are accelerated by the magnetosphere and then go to the poles that produce the aurora. In the case of Jupiter, for example, we can have also contribution from particles from the volcanic plumes of Io, or in Saturn, you can have contribution also from the particles in the rim of the planet. On the other hand, airflow is mainly initiated by the absorption of solar photons.
not particles, but photons that produce chemical reactions that then produce this halo.
Well, aurora had been known since ancient times. The discovery of the halo is relatively recent. It was only in the 19th century that astronomers began to realize that not all the light in the night sky came from the stars, or from the diffusion of solar light by the, for example, the solar collider. There was something more. In 1968, Armstrong made the first detection of the oxygen grid line outside aurora regions, and he called that a non-polar aurora. But at that time, it was not clear if that light came from the atmosphere or came from outside the atmosphere, some stellar light being diffused or something like that. It was only in 1909 that INTEMAP proved that light came from the atmosphere. To do that, he made some photometric studies. He just looked at the light coming from different directions, and he found that when you look at the horizon, the light was more intense than when looking at the zenith. That's indicating that the light does not come from outside the atmosphere, because you have more absorption of light by the atmosphere when you look to the horizon. But it's something coming from the atmosphere itself, because you have a larger emitting region when you look at the horizon than at the zenith. And he called that Earth light or permanent aurora. It was only in the 50s that the halo term was first used, and it was also in the 50s that the first observation of halo in another planet, in this case of Venus, was made by a Russian astronomer. And I have to say, I think it's important to say that the IAEA has been deeply involved in the studies of the halo since the Institute was created. Now we have a very good witness, that's in the main door of the Institute, this rocket. Rockets like these were launched, I think, in the late 70s, early 80s, I don't know better when that's correct, to study the halo in the upper atmosphere of the Earth, to study emissions from oxygen and from hydroxy. And also we have in the Sierra Nevada Observatory, there is one instrument study that is used to permanently, to continuously monitor the hydroxyl halo coming from the terrestrial mesosphere. And of course, we are also involved in a space mission to the Earth or to other planets to analyze the light coming from those planets. And the reason is that the halo provides a lot of information about regions that are the upper atmosphere that are very difficult to study by any other means. So halo gives us information about the temperature, the abundances of different species, the dynamics, the winds, the waves, etc. And this is very difficult to obtain by any other means. So in my case, I'm interested in the halo in Mars, so I think it's important to spend just some minutes summarizing the basic features of the Martian climate combined with the terrestrial atmosphere. So Mars is smaller, it's a small planet, about half of the Earth, so the gravity is less, and it has less capacity to gravitationally retain its atmosphere. So this is one of the reasons that the Martian atmosphere is much thinner than the terrestrial one. So the surface pressure on Mars is less than 1/100 the one on the Earth. And this has important consequences. One of that is that this is close to the triple point of water, so meaning that liquid water is usually not stable in the surface of Mars. Currently, you cannot have liquid water on the surface of Mars. Another consequence is that a thin atmosphere has less capacity to redistribute the heat, so you have much larger temperature differences on Mars than on the Earth. The inclination of the axis of rotation of Mars is similar to the one of the Earth, meaning that we have seasons on Mars as we have on the Earth. But the difference is that the Martian orbit is much more eccentric, and this is going to impose an asymmetry into the seasonal cycle. So to visualize this seasonal cycle, I'm going to show an animation showing how the temperature in the lower atmosphere changed with seasons. So at the beginning, we have it's summer in the northern hemisphere, so temperatures are larger there. Then we go to the summer in the north, to the south, sorry, the summer in the south. Again, another year, the summer in the south. So these are real measurements taken by an instrument looking at the daytime and the dayside of the planet in the lower atmosphere. And also, it's important to note that when it is summer in the lower atmosphere, the temperature in the southern hemisphere, sorry, the temperatures are larger than when it's summer in the northern hemisphere. And this is a consequence of the eccentricity of the Martian orbit. So to measure the, I think it's important, because we will be talking about seasonal evolution later, it's important to mention how seasons are
study for Mars. So we don't have months that we have on the Earth. We measure the season with this value, LS, the solar longitude. So that, LS is zero when it is the spring equinox in the northern hemisphere. It's 90 for the summer solstice in the northern hemisphere, and it's 270 for the for the summer in the southern hemisphere. So the orbit of Mars is such as that Mars is farther from the sun when it is summer in the northern hemisphere, and it is closer to the sun it's in the perihelion when it's summer in the southern hemisphere. And this explains the asymmetry in the temperatures in the summer in the south and in the north that we saw before. So this is to compare a typical temperature profile for Mars and from the Earth in green. So the main difference is that on Earth we have this temperature inversion here, the stratosphere, that is produced by the absorption of ozone, the absorption of solar radiation by ozone. On Mars we have much less ozone, so we don't have a stratosphere. But under some conditions we can have something similar to a stratosphere on Mars. Mars is known for the dust storms. Sometimes dust storms develop on Mars, and in some years they can even cover the full Martian sky, the full planet. When dust storm, there is a dust storm on Mars, the dust storm absorbs the solar radiation in the atmosphere and produces a heating in the atmosphere and a cooling in the surface, producing this thermal inversion in the similar to the stratosphere of the Earth. In fact, the temperatures in the lower atmosphere are very strongly linked to the dust amount in the lower atmosphere. So this is showing 3 years, 3 Martian years of measurements of dust opacity, the amount of dust in the lower atmosphere, and this is temperature in the lower atmosphere. You can see how well they both correlate. So it will be very important to take into account the effects of the dust when discussing results about Mars. And you will see that can be also felt even in the upper atmosphere. So for Mars, our interest is in the upper atmosphere of the planet, lies above maybe 80, 100 kilometers. Why? Well, there are many reasons, but it's curious that one of the motivations to study the upper atmosphere comes from the surface, from the geological record. There are mineralogical and morphological evidences that there was liquid water running on Mars during relatively long periods of time, yes, in the distant past, 4 billion years ago. How much water there was there and for how long, we don't know, but there was some water. And this implies that the atmosphere of Mars in the past had to be different to the current one, because we cannot have liquid water today. So the atmosphere in the past had to be thicker and had to be warmer. How much thicker and warmer, we don't know. What happened to that atmosphere? Well, we think that a significant part of that just escaped the planet because of the low gravity of the planet. So studying how the atmosphere escapes from the planet, from Mars, is very important to understand how was the climate of Mars in the past and to understand the climate evolution of the planet. There are many different processes producing atmospheric escape to space. I will not get into detail, but all of them mutually depend on the conditions of the upper atmosphere, on the temperature and density on the upper atmosphere. So characterizing the variability of the upper atmosphere today and the variability that induced on the escape of the atmosphere today is very important to understand how much atmosphere was lost in the process in the Martian history, and to get information about how was the Martian climate really in the past. So to understand the upper atmosphere of Mars, we use two different tools, if you want. We use observations from space missions. We are involved in 3 missions to Mars, Mars Express. The normal mission is, the whole department is heavily involved in this mission. Pepper Pan is co-PI of the instrument, the main device of the instrument here. And I'm also a collaborator of the MAVEN IUVS team. And we also use models. So later I will describe a bit more the observations I'm going to use, but let me just say a few words about my favorite tool, the GCM. The GCM, it stands for Global Climate Model, is just like a virtual planet that you build on a computer that ideally, which is never the case, behaves like the real one. And using only universal equations, no buttons to play with or values to play on. GCM usually divide the atmosphere in a three-dimensional grid and can be divided in 2 parts. A dynamical curve, which solves the equations of hydrodynamics on a sphere, and a set of physical processes in each atmospheric column that are used to set the, both the temperature and the compositional states of the atmosphere and to force the dynamics. On Mars, probably the most advanced GCM is the one developed at the LD, the Laboratoire de l'Hydrologie Dynamique of the University in Paris, in collaboration with the Open University in the United Kingdom and with the IAEA in Canada. This model has been used for many different studies, from classic things such as the CO2 cycle and the water cycle on Mars, to more, many more exotic things such as the radon cycle or the simulation of volcanic eruptions of Mars. This model originally extended only up to 80 kilometers. During my PhD, I developed parametrizations for the physical processes important in the upper atmosphere. These were incorporated into the GCM that was then extended to 250 kilometers. So this was the first global model for Mars that could study the whole atmosphere from the surface of the planet until the X-rays where the atmosphere diluted into the interplanetary space. So this is a very powerful tool. Okay, now let's go to science. In the first part, I will summarize a paper we published last year about the airflow in the dayside of the planet, what is called the dayglow, using observations of the SPICAM instrument on both Mars Express and the Global Climate Model. So the dayglow of Mars has been observed since the Mariner times in the 70s. So I'm going to focus here in the two most prominent emission systems in the UV. The Cameron bands that extend from 180 to 260 nanometers, more or less, that are indicated by these purple boxes, and the UV doublet at around 290 nanometers, that is indicated by this orange box. So what's the origin of these emission systems? Well, the UV doublet comes from the excitation of the V2 sigma excited state of the CO2 plus ion. How is this state populated? Well, it's simple, a CO2 molecule can be ionized either by a solar photon in the UV or by impact with a photoelectron. Photoelectrons are just electrons with high energy that have been previously created in another photoionization. So part of the CO2 plus ions that are formed by this reaction are in this excited state that then a few collisions there relax by emitting a photon in the UV doublet. For the Cameron bands, the emission comes from this excited state of the CO molecule, and the population mechanism is a bit more complex. So you can have photodissociation or photoelectron impact dissociation of CO2. Part of the CO molecules that are formed will be in this excited state and will relax. But there are other possibilities. There is also this this state can be excited by a collision electron impact excitation of CO directly, on by the dissociative recombination of CO2 plus. But it's important that previously it was thought that this was the dominant mechanism of this emission. And this implies that if you look at the altitude variability of the emission, how the emission changes with altitude, what is called the scale height, that could be given by the scale height of CO2, by how the CO2 density decreases with altitude. And this is given by the temperature. So by studying how this emission decreases with altitude, you could get information on the density, on the temperature, sorry. And we will see later that it's probably was an incorrect assumption. Okay, so there are different models that have been developed to study these atmospheric emissions. They use different techniques, different approaches, but all of them are they only consider variations in the vertical direction. On one hand, that's good because that allows for a very detailed treatment of the processes involved. But on the other hand, it just decouples the emission from the atmospheric variability. You cannot reproduce the full atmospheric variability with a 1D model. You need a global model. So these are some examples of results obtained with 1D model, just to show the shape of the emission. You can see that there is a peak at around 120, 130 kilometers of altitude. So our aim was to fully characterize the variability of the dayglow. For that, we used the GCM and we also a SPICAM observation. The SPICAM observations had already been analyzed before, but only for a little subset of observations taken during the first year of the working of the instrument. So we wanted to use the full data set to study things, for example, the variability that had not been studied before. So when we started this project, the GCN did not include a model to reproduce the data. So basically, we didn't have all the processes dealing with photoelectrics. So I spent a lot of time just implementing that new module on the GCN, implementing how the photoelectrons are created, how the energy of the photoelectrons degrades with the interaction with the atmosphere. That's a lot of time. I have just devoted 10 seconds to that, and no slide, but that took 1 year of work. So really, model development is really a time-consuming activity. So let me say a few words about the observations we are going to use. Mars Express was the first European mission sent to another planet, to Mars. It got to Martian orbit, it was Christmas 2003, so we just recently celebrated 15 years in Martian orbit. The mission is still healthy, working very well. All of the instruments, with just one exception, are still working nominally, so that's very high, a very good success of the European Space Agency. One of the instruments is SPICAM. It's a dual infrared and UV spectrometer. It covers from 120 to 320 nanometers with 1.5 spectral resolution. SPICAM can have different observing modes. You can look below to the surface of the planet, you can nadir. You can make stellar rotations, you can make solar rotations, and you can also look at the limb of the planet. And that's the observing mode that is of interest for us, because then you can really see the emission of the atmosphere. Unfortunately, the only instrument on Mars Express that is no longer working is the UV spectrometer in the speaker. It stopped working in 2014, so it's no longer working. In total, we have around 300 observations with the SPICAM looking at the limb with a good geometry to observe these emissions. This is an example of one of these observations. So this is plotting the intensity of the emission as a function of altitude and wavelength. So these are the Cameron bands. This is the CO2 plus UWS. This is the hydrogen lemma alpha emission. We are interested not in the spectrum itself, but what we do is just we make a spectral integration of the intensity here to get a profile and an integrated emission profile, and that's what we will be working with. Not all the SPICAM observations are as nice as this one. There are some cases in which there is a lot of stray light, just diffuse solar light coming from the lower atmosphere that gets into the instrument and that really ruins the observations. You can see that there are some hints of the emission, the cameraman's there, but you cannot see that because of this stray light. In some other cases, there are problems with the detector, there are oscillations, there are black stripes. So after removing all these bad observations, the full SPICAM data set reduced to about 120 emission profiles. And this is on the distribution of the profiles as a function of LS, of season, and latitude with different colors indicating different observations of 10 different Martian years. So previously, only these observations here, the black observations here, have been analyzed. So we have improved. Increase the data set. So to compare with the model, what we have done is we have made a simulation with the model covering a full Martian year, including the daily simulator. And then for each of these data points here, we have really interpolated the prediction of the model at the exact location and time of each observation. Then we have integrated the emission rate predicted by the model on the line of sight of a SPICAM to produce the slant profiles, and then we have compared them. So this is an example of a good comparison, GCN in red, SPICAM in blue, and in some other cases the comparison is not that good. So we are going to focus the comparison on just two parameters, the altitude at which the emission peaks and the intensity of the emission at the peak. So this plot is showing the comparison of the emission of the peak, the variability of the emission of the peak for the Cameron bands and the UV doublet as a function of solar zenith angle, basically the elevation of the sun in the sky. Blue is the observation, the SPICAM observation, and this black here and red here is the prediction of the model. So you can see in this case, in both cases, the decrease of the intensity when increasing solar zenith angle when the sun goes lower into the atmosphere is well predicted by the intensity. Strongly overestimated by the model for the camera bands. But this is not something new. That also was found in previous studies with 1D models. What happens here is that there are good reasons to think that the cross-section of electron impact on CO2 but it's very important to simulate this emission, which were measured in the 70s, were not very, that was a very tricky measurement, so but they were not very correctly measured, and they had to divide it. So they need to be divided by a factor of three. When you take that into account, then you get the right points here that actually are much better argumented observations. Still, there is some overestimation, but that's just on the order of the uncertainties in the other cross section, so that's more or less okay. If we look at the altitude of the peak, the seasonal variability of the altitude of the peak, in this case, blue and black is the observations, and red is the simulation, you can see that both the model and the observations display this increase of the altitude of the peak from here to here, from aphelion to perihelion. So this is just a consequence of the eccentricity of the Martian orbit. Here, we are far away from the sun, the atmosphere is colder, it's more compact, and the altitude of this emission increases. Here, we are closer to the sun, a warmer, more expanded atmosphere, and larger altitudes here. But in fact, the variability, which is predicted by the model, is less than what is observed. I would like to focus on this region here, the perihelion season. I have these observations indicated in black were obtained during Martian year 28. And we know that at this time of the year, for Martian year 28, there was a global dust storm. So maybe these high altitudes are due to that global dust storm. But these altitudes during Martian year 28 are higher than the altitudes measured of other Martian years. So in this simulation, we used what we call the climatological dust scenario, and a scenario without any global dust storm. If we put into the model the dust that was measured during Martian year 28, including the dust storm, then what we have is these yellow points. When you compare with the red ones, you can see that there is an increase in the altitude of the peak due to the global dust storm of about 10 kilometers. This is not enough to have a perfect comparison with the model that helps, but this is telling us that these high altitudes here are really a consequence of the dust storm. So the dust storm that happens in the lower atmosphere of Mars can be felt up to 140, 150 kilometers of far. So with this global model, the first global model to simulate the Tegel, we have produced global maps of the emission just to better understand the variability we are seeing. So this is just an example showing the variability with latitude and season of the intensity of the peak. So here you can see the seasonal cycle of Mars. You can see how the latitude of the maximum emission moves with the subsolar point. So here is the summer in the north, here is the summer in the south. And you can also see the eccentricity of the Martian orbit again. So you have less emission in aphelion than perihelion just because you have less solar photons getting to the planet here and here. Just to illustrate the importance of taking into account the atmospheric variability, I'm showing here the variability of the pre-emission rate for the coming months as a function of latitude, local time, and longitude for three different seasons. I will just focus on this particular panel here. So with the longitudinal variability for the equinox season. You can see that there is a longitudinal variability in the altitude of the peak here. In fact, if you make a cut at a constant altitude, this variability will show up as a longitudinal variability in the emission. What is producing this? Well, this is just the consequence of the waves and tides in the atmosphere of Mars. So if you look at the variability, longitudinal variability of the density here, you can see these structures that are produced by tides in the upper atmosphere of the planet that really correlate well with what we see in the Deglo. So this is telling us that the Deglo that we can relatively easily observe is giving us information on the density, on the wave structure and the tides. That is also the density, but it is much harder to see. So again, ergo is a very nice tool to observe the behavior of the upper atmosphere of the planet. And just to finish with this part, as I said before, it's commonly assumed that all the emission in the Cameron bands ultimately comes from CO2. But our model says something different. So this is showing the relative contribution of the electron impact excitation on CO as a function to the emission in the Cameron bands as a function of season, as a function of altitude. So you can see that there is a strong seasonal variability, and in some cases the contribution can be as large as 40-50%. So this is not at all negligible. Even when you look at this season where the contribution is lower, you find that the contribution really increases with altitude. So this is telling us that the altitude variation of this atmospheric emission is not given by the, is not that of CO2, but it, that's of a mixture of CO2 and CO. So this means that the temperature measurements that was derived, the temperature that was derived from the scale height of this emission from the measurements in the Mariner and in the SPICAM emission are very likely biased. So this should not be used. And this is an important result because this was the only, these were the only measurements of temperature in the upper atmosphere of Mars that we had before Mars express. Okay, moving now to the night side of the planet. So this is our work we are currently doing in collaboration with the MAVEN IUVS team. We saw before that the day glow was observed already by the Mariner missions in the 70s, but the night glow, the discovery of the night glow is much more recent. It was found for the first time by SPICAM in 2005, because this is a much dimmer mission. So this is the first spectra of the day glow, of the night glow of Mars, sorry, taken by SPICAM. You can see lines in the delta and gamma bands of NO, of nitric oxide. So what is producing this emission? These emissions are produced by the recombination of a nitrogen and an oxygen atoms in the nightside of the planet. But these atoms are not produced in the nightside of the planet. Let me go back. So they are produced by photodissociation of CO2 and N2 in the dayside of the planet, and then they are transported over the winter pole. There is a descent curve here, and then the atoms recombine to produce the emission. So this emission, this NO natural, is not giving us information about the NO density or about the temperature. It's giving us information about the circulation in the atmosphere, about the winds. And this is very important because winds in the upper atmosphere of Mars have never been measured before. So this is a very nice data set to constrain the model. So shortly after these first observations were published, we incorporated into the model and into the GCM a new model to calculate the night glow and to see what could be seen as a in the Martian year. So this is the prediction of the model, the intensity of the emission as a function of latitude and season for a Martian year. So basically, in the solstices, the model creates a very strong emission in the winter poles. And the reason is that the circulation in the atmosphere goes just from the summer hemisphere in the north, or from the summer hemisphere to the winter hemisphere. During the equinox seasons, is both the model predicts a strong emission in both poles. And this is because the circulation in that case goes from the low latitudes to the high latitudes of both hemispheres. And also there is, during the equinox, there is some residual emission in the low latitudes. So unfortunately, the SPICAM data set indicated by these circles here was not enough to be able to constrain the dynamic, the behavior of the model. There are very few observations. Just 2 years ago, we made a comparison using observations by MAVEN, by the instrument IUVS, looking at the LEAP. But the problem with the observations is that the observations that are indicated here in white, over the predicted NELU map on the model, are also only taking short periods of time, and they don't have a complete latitudinal coverage. They don't really get into the poles to really see this increase of the emission predicted by the model. So what I will be showing today is another different observation by the IUVS instrument of MAVEN. So let me just say a few words about MAVEN and IUVS. MAVEN is a NASA mission that was launched in 2014, still working. It's devoted to the study of the upper atmosphere of Mars, the interaction with the solar wind, with the solar radiation, and the escape of the atmosphere. One of the instruments, our remote sensing instruments, is IUVS. It's a UV imaging spectrometer with similar spectral range and spectral resolution than SPICAM, but it has a scan mirror. And that's important because with that scan mirror, you can really look at different portions of the planet without having to turn the whole spacecraft. So IUVS can have different observing modes, can look at Nadir, can look at the LEAP, can make augmentations, but the observations that are of interest for us is the observations that are taken in the aquabs of MAVEN, when MAVEN is very far away from the planet. And then using the scan mirror, you can make global images of the night side of the planet or of the planet. So you can see here these scans that are used to build an almost global image of the full night side of the planet. And this is with just one single image. We have much more information than with the whole SPICAM IUVS link dataset. Here you can really see how the intensity increases toward the winter poles in this case. You can see that there is a lot of spatial variability. You can see that there are areas of enhanced emission in the low latitude, etc. In each of the pixels here, we have a full spectrum. So we can, in each pixel, we can really get the intensity emitted by the molecules. In total, we have with these images, that the images we have covered more than 1 month a year, we have around 30 million data points. And that more, almost 100,000 times more than we had before. So this is really a great data set to constrain the model. So we have put all the observations, we have pinned all the observations as a function of latitude and season. This is what is observed. And you can already see that this is more or less similar to what the model is. To make a proper comparison, we have made with this data set the same thing that we did with SPICAM. So we have made a simulation with the model covering all the period that has been observed by MAVEN using the observed day-to-day variability of the solar flux and of the dust load. And then we have, for each of the pixels here, we have really got into the model, extracted the prediction of the model at that particular location and time, and just make a vertical integration along the line of sight. So this is what happens when you compare the plot, the maps from the observations and from the model. I don't know if you can see very well. It's not very good. But you can see that some of the features that are predicted by the model are confirmed by the observations. So you can have here at perihelion, you have an intense emission in the winter pole. Here you have intense emission in the winter pole, in the southern summer. In the equinox season, you have here, around here and around here, emissions in both poles. You have also this area here of enhanced emission in the low latitudes in the equinox. So really, to first order, it seems that the dynamics in the model is working okay. Of course, there are differences at that where the intensity things come. For example, you have here this time where there was an enhancement of emission observed by IUVS that is not reproduced by your observations. Another difference is that in general, the low latitudes are darker in the model than in the observations. And also, for example, here, the area of enhanced emission in the low latitudes here to be the spring equinox is more intense and lasts longer in the model than in the observations. But if you go to the fall equinox, the situation is the opposite. It's more intense in the observations of in the model. So this is something that we have recently obtained, that we are just starting to try to understand these differences. If we make an average as a function of the observations and of the data as a function of latitude, this is what we have. So this is the model, this is latitude, and this is the intensity, the integrated intensity, and this is this is the observation, and this is the model. So you can say the structure is similar, but the values are not in agreement very well. So this is the ratio, this is putting the ratio between the model and the observations. If we make a raw average of this ratio, we see that the model is underestimating the total emission. And we think that this is because we are not including all the production mechanisms of nitrogen and oxygen. In particular, we are not including the electron impact dissociation of CO2 and N2 that on Venus, in the case of Venus, is not really important. If you look at the latitudinal representation of the differences, you see that the model tends to underestimate the emission in the lower mid-latitudes and to overestimate the emission in the high latitudes. So this is probably telling us that the model is pushing too strongly towards the poles. That is, the circulation is too intense. The meridional winds are probably too intense in the model. And this may be because a possible reason is that we are not including the model, the position of momentum by the small scale gravity waves that can have an influence of the dynamics. But that's understandable. And another interesting result, this information that can be obtained from this data set is about the tides and waves in the upper atmosphere of Mars. So in this plot, we have put together all the data obtained from IUVS as a function of latitude and longitude. And we have, at each point, we have plotted the difference with respect to the mean at that, the longitudinal mean at that particular latitude. So this is the, when we do that with the model, with the observation, sorry, and this is when we do that with the model. And you can see that there is sample, that they are quite similar. Let me go a bit more into the detail. So if you look at the high latitudes in the northern hemisphere, IUVS shows a wave 2 structure. We have a minimum here, a maximum here, minimum, a maximum. And the model does the same thing. Of a minimum, maximum. This is the phases probably slightly different, but to first order, that's a very good argument. If you look at the low latitudes here, you can see that the observations indicate a wave 3, so minimum, maximum, minimum, maximum, minimum, maximum. That is also very well reproduced by the model. So minimum, maximum, minimum, maximum, minimum, maximum. Also, the relative intensity of this maximum of these areas of enhanced emission is also well reproduced by the model. And finally, if you look at the high latitudes in the southern hemisphere, then you have the observations indicate a wave 1 structure, so maximum and minimum, and this also reproduced by the model. So to first order, it seems that the waves, that the model is doing a very nice job in reproducing the waves and tides in the other hemisphere of Mars. Of course, there are differences. For example, these areas here of very strong emission, which are not seen in the observations, but to first order, the agreement is quite good. And this good agreement allows us to use the model to make a Fourier decomposition of the structures here, something that we cannot do with the observations because we don't have a full local time coverage, and then try to identify which particular waves or tides are producing these structures. So we're not getting into the detail, we just saw an example for the low latitudes here. This wave three structure, what we find that this is the intensity, the contribution of different wave modes to that structure we see. And we see that it's the diurnal eastward wave two component that is producing, dominating that structure. So we can use the model to get more information that we cannot get from the observations. So I finish here, just as a summary. We have analyzed atmospheric emission on the day side and in the night side of Mars. We get information of the temperature, the density, and the dynamics in the upper atmosphere of the planet. I think the two main conclusions is that air glow is really a powerful tool to get information about the upper atmosphere of Mars, something that you can hardly do with other kind of observations. And the other conclusion is that global models are really needed to interpret these observations. You can get more information when you combine the observations with a global model that gives you all the observations. We have found that both the Niagara and the Debris are strongly coupled to the variability of the atmosphere that are affected by waves. Another important result is that the camera bands are used to have temperatures on Mars, and we have used the Niagara observations to validate the dynamics, the circulation predicted by NOAA. And that's all. Thank you.
Thank you, Francisco, for this nice talk. It's open for questions.
Of Mars, and the process is quite fast. In fact, I made a simulation to check that. I made a simulation in which I just started from a uniform nitrogen everywhere at all points of the planet, and just one day later, the model had already created the emission in the winter pole. So that transport is really a very fast process.
As far as I remember, SPICAM had another channel in the middle infrared.
Yeah.
And there was a very nice measurement of the 127 micro.
Yeah, of the O2 micro. Yeah.
Yeah. You know that when we start measuring the terrestrial infrared air glow, one of the band we measured in the air was 127 micro.
Yeah.
Of O2. But it's you don't use this data? You
we have not used that. We focus on the UVB, but in fact we can simulate that emission with the model. That's very easy because that's just the recombination of oxygen atoms, and if you do that, you get a very similar picture to that of the NO night glow. The only difference is that the NO night glow is produced at maybe 80 kilometers of altitude, mm-hmm. and the O2 night glow is a bit lower, maybe 50, 40 kilometers. But the overall picture is just the same. We just never went to the observations to compare with the model, but yeah.
Very nice talk. One question coming back to the light glow, the recombination reaction with a relative short time, which it takes to happen. So you said that it's mainly meridional circulation which is generating this, that means transport into the night region. So that, yeah, seems clear to me that this happens when it goes into the polar night region, but this would also imply that meridional winds are extremely fast.
Yeah.
What about solar winds? Isn't there any solar contribution at the terminator region?
In fact, in the terminator, most of the emission happens, if you go to the observations, most of the emission happens just before midnight. And in particular, if you go at the low latitudes. And the explanation why that is just before midnight and not just at midnight, as one would expect if you have fully symmetric circulation, is probably that the zonal winds are just moving the emission of the atoms towards towards the morning, towards the terminator. Yeah, meridional winds, zonal winds have also a contribution, yeah, to this solution.
So do you have a rough idea about the velocity, the wind velocity?
In the thermosphere, they can be like 200, 300 meters per second. Both the meridional and the zonal ones, yeah.
Thank you very much. Francisco, I have a question also on the night glow. I'm really impressed that you're really able to reproduce the longitudinal variation even at the very tiny atmosphere up there. You mentioned there about the overestimation at the low latitude and overestimation of the high and under of the low.
Correct. We underestimate.
But you mentioned the gravity wave. So I have a question about that, because gravity wave normally acts from the vertical direction mainly, but how can you think about the gravity wave could actually influence the latitudinal distribution?
Well, because when you deposit the momentum that is transported by the gravity waves from the lower atmosphere to the upper atmosphere, you are really depositing energy, and that will go into either direction. You can accelerate the meridional wind, or you can decelerate the meridional flow. So that's the physical mechanism.
So
there are models which include this mechanism. They have made studies just showing the model results without the dynamics of the model, without the gravity waves and with the gravity waves, and you can see some differences. So yeah, you can really change the meridional winds if you change the deposition, if you include the deposition of momentum.
Yeah, this is not direct transport by the gravity wave, but by indirect effect because they influence the meridional wave.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay. Thanks.
Hello. I just like to thank you for the talk, which I found very, very interesting. And just taking the idea from Pepe here, who was suggesting looking at 1.27. Do you think that just because you have information about different altitudes, maybe you can have some information about the propagation of the tides, and then you get an additional information? So
yeah.
Using both.
Yes. Yeah, but the problem is that this 1.27 night glow has only been observed by the SPICAM, and the distribution of the observation. There are very few observations out there, not very well distributed. So yeah, I'd love to do this very same plot. I love to do that with the O2 night glow to see what happens at a different altitude, but we cannot do that at the moment because we don't have the observations to do that.
Any other question? This one?
This one, which is so strong in comparison with the model.
You mean this?
This is the model and
this is
no,
the model
this
and
is the observation.
So you mean this one or the ones with the cycles?
This one in comparison with the model.
Yeah,
which is so,
in fact,
so different and we do have an idea.
Yeah. In fact, when you look at the model results, not only at the negro, what you see is that there is a strong descent of air coming from the upper atmosphere to the lower atmosphere here. So that the intensity here is larger than here, it probably means that this descent of air is overestimated by the model. And it's also related to the meridional winds, because that's produced by the meridional circulation that passes to the poles, and in the night side, in the equinox, you have the winds go and converge in the low latitudes. Probably that convergence, because the circulation is probably too intense. So it's in the same direction than the comparison of the overall emission.
My voice is really bad. So what do you expect NOMA, TGO, ACS to contribute this? By adding measurements, certainly in the 127 micron, there would be a lot of measurements.
Yes, the 127 micron would be a good target. The problem is, well, for the UV emissions, they really fall within the spectral range of UVs, the UV part of NOAA. The problem is that UVs is really optimized to make solar rotations. So it's not really thought to look at the faint emissions. So I don't really know if we are going to be able even to observe these weak emissions with NOAA. But that's something, the first observations have been made, so we really need to go into the data and to look for that. But the 1.27 micron could be observed by ACS, I think.
Yes.
So yeah, could be a nice step, yeah.
And well, the second question is regarding the day glow. You mentioned that possibly there is a bias in all the temperature determinations using day glow observation so far, which is one of the best tools to detect the temperature in the upper atmosphere. So are you planning to make a revision of all data sets? Is that really possible? There is maybe a kind of correction factor or something that could be applied in order to find out?
What we want to do is we want to work with the model results. So we have profiles of the emission in the camera months on the UV-doublet. So what we are going to do is just to ignore that temperatures will not be retrieved from the camera months. We are going to retrieve temperatures to get temperatures from the scale height of the emissions in both cases, and then we are going to compare with the real temperatures predicted by the model, with the real temperature profile. And this is going to give us an estimation on how large the error is. So note that this error only affects the camera months, because the UVW that is also used to get temperature is not affected. It's all produced by CO2, so it should give a good estimation of the temperature. Yeah. But we are going to estimate the error using the model.
One more question.
Yeah,
I think
very short. That very short came to me when Miguel mentioned the GEO, and also thinking CO. Which is really a very good tracer, carbon monoxide. Would that help in understanding the circulation there?
It would help because that's a good tracer of circulation, but it would really help much more to understand. I plotted the contribution of CO to the emission in the Cameron bands, you saw that there was a lot of seasonal variability.
Yeah.
And that seasonal variability is directly driven by the seasonal variability of the CO abundance in the model.
Right.
But we don't know, the CO has never been measured before, so we don't know if the model is right or not. Maybe it's not correct. So NOAA measurements are going to be very useful to really constrain the seasonal variability of the CO abundance predicted by the model. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you again for the speaker.